And hello and welcome to EP16. This is going to be partly technical, partly car, partly bits and bobs. But at the moment we're on technical work. I'll just take you through to the car before we take you back to find out what the hell that is. Car is all done. Lights on, lights on. So there's nothing for me to do on the car. It's all welded up. And all I'm doing now is waiting for my jig to arrive, which attaches on these mount points. We flip the car over and we transport the car out away to the soda blasting depot. I'm going to take the trestles across to the soda blasters and they're going to be able to spin the car and just take... There's not much to do underneath, but they're just going to go over it and then prime it with an etch prime. Then it'll come back here for me to do the gravy on it. There's no welding to do on the car. We finished all that on 15, really. There might be one or two little plugs or grind downs, but nothing I can't do when it gets back. So that takes us care of the shell. When it comes back from soda, we're going to be putting it out, leaving it outside or outside this area anyway, so I can get the doors on, the bonnet on, and do the lineup. So there'll be lineup work as well on it, but for now, we're waiting just to get the time slot in for the blasting place. So it's looking like about a week away for that. In the meantime, I'll take you over to the back to that diagram then. Well, this is the what you call a schematic, or not even a schematic, it's my idea of a circuit diagram, which gives me a plan for the electrics, because I need to get the electrics and harness and wiring looms being built while I've got downtime. So this is jobs that need to be done whilst we're waiting for the shell. No point wasting available time. So these diagrams here just show circuitry. The middle of the diagram is the radio. And as you know, on Swampy, it was all Bluetooth controlled and stuff. So these are all to help me plan out my modules and project boxes. This is a project box, which is just a plastic box, ABS plastic box, which I use to contain my electronic items to control the systems in the car. So the core of it is the radio. We've got a Bluetooth hands-free, we've got the sat nav, we've got a dimming mirror there. I'll show you that later. It's electronically dimmed mirror unit which I've adapted to fit in the car. You'll see about that later. It's a plug-in on an original Ford Cortina radio mirror stalk. I'll explain why that's the case later on. USB supply unit which powers the sat nav. This shows your locations of fuses and how it connects into the car loom, what feeds on the car loom. You've got speakers there, electric aerial, the subwoofer unit under the seat, tweeters above your head, the control unit for the MP3. And that's what that's all about. That gives me a way of planning out what I need to put into position for the wiring harness. There's an immobiliser system as well, which isn't actually shown on there, but there's an immobiliser system which piggybacks on top of this on its own separate system. The reason for the immobiliser not being on this is because if there was a fault with the immobiliser and I was totally out, I need to be able to fault find that separately. So that's a separate system which stacks on top of this. It does interface into it, but I won't be showing that on the video. It'll just be the car is immobilised in various ways. I won't be covering that on the video for obvious reasons. So upstairs now, and I'll show you the radio on the bench. So here we are in my temporary workshop. I'm actually pinched somebody's office at work because it's the whole place was getting decorated. And there's a window gap of a month where I can sneak into an empty unit and pinch their desk. I could do this at home, but it's just a bit of a nicer place here to work, and there's free heat, so I'm going to take their offer on it. Here's our radio. Okay, so although I'll just drop the volume, we're on a different radio station here. I'm going to be really careful with the radio. Last video, episode 15, you'll notice there's two versions, and that's just because in the background the radio picked up a couple of copyrighted songs which I had to remove and then re-upload the film. It's a pain in the arse. Anyway, here's our radios. Let's talk about the radio first. It's going to form the heart of the dashboard. You'll see the dashboard there. That's not the actual dash I'm using. This is just a test bed dashboard. The actual ruby dash has gone away for its paint. This is just to help me get an idea of distances and areas where I'm going to fit the modules. So here's one of those modules here. This is the MP3 unit. I can work out how I'm going to position things and how it's going to work when it's in the car. There might be some slight improvements on Swampy, the way I did it on Swampy, but not a mega difference. So what have we got? We've got a radio. This is a Blaupunkt, which is a 1970-71 set, put in by Ford in early cars before they changed over to the cheap Taiwan sets. A Blaupunkt Mannheim. Okay, nice set, quality build. All the Blaupunkts, the early Blaupunkts, were good quality sets, good components, high quality components. You can see, or I can see from this, knowing on the capacitors and stuff, electronic components, you just know the difference between cheap and not. Some sets from the 70s were just thrown together, but the Blaupunkts were well known to be well built. The components here, just all, it's all good quality stuff. So what I'm saying is, they're built, these bit things are built good, these sets. They did quite a few different models, all similar frontage on the early 71s, with this round bezel that slots through the dash slot, slots through the bezel plate. Here's the bezel plate, which all fits nicely in the dash. Okay, so this Mannheim set has got, it's good because it's got FM on it. Now, a lot of people didn't think FM was around the 70s, but it was. It was a higher end set there, so it had the FM on it. There's the FM button. It's actually in the wrong place. FM's actually here. These buttons pop off. I've not clipped them on in the right place. So three controls, FM, long wave and medium. A tone switch there, and then a power off on switch there. Now, I didn't like the fact that you switched it off and on with that button, but unfortunately these Mannheim sets were produced with the on off switch here as opposed to a click. What I did was, I've used that for the MP3. I'll show you about that in a minute. I'll explain that in a minute. I've put a new pot in here, a volume adjusting pot. They're called pots, short for potentiometer, which is a volume control. On the back of it, this one's got an off on switch, so I've converted this set to click off and on the switch. I like that. Didn't have electric aerial, so we tapped into the power switch and we get a wire out for the electric aerial, so we can, the antenna can automatically elevate up with that wire. So that's that wire. To control the MP3, this is covered in another film, but I'll recover it again because I've probably got new viewers on this channel who haven't seen the early Swampy films with the MP3. The good thing about the Blaupunkt sets is they come with a lead at the back which you can plug audio into. It has this cap on it here which you pull out, and then you insert this DIN plug which you have to build up. I've built this one up. And all this was for when they had cassette players. And if you had, in the 70s, you had your cassette player from Blaupunkt, you'd unplug this, it's not a blanking plug, it's a jumper plug. You'd take that out and plug your cassette in the back, and that would control the cassette input. So all that happens with this is the radio signal comes out on that left pin inside on this socket, and then just links back through the pin back on itself. So by pulling this out, you interrupt the amplifier and you can tap into the radio signal and the line in, you would call it line in. So all you do is you build a lead up which intercepts the amplifier stage, the line in stage. That lead then goes round and it ends up inside my module, where I can then inject the MP3 signal into it. This red wire is going to that plug there, this black wire is going to that plug there. So there's only two, only dealing with two cables. The radio signal's coming in on the red wire, and the input to the amp is coming in on the black. So if you just join those up, you're back to how it was. That's equivalent to just linking that pin back into the socket. You're just basically looping the signal right round through the cable. But what happens is, when my MP3 boots up, I'll have a relay which separates these out, then puts the MP3 signal into the lining. If you're into electronics, you'll probably know what I'm trying to say. If you're not, then it's going to be a little bit of double dutch, for which I apologise. So non-technically, what's going to happen is I'll switch this on, it will then become an MP3 system, and these buttons will then start to control the control of the MP3 player. By turning that off, it becomes a complete stock radio with no alterations at all. So total stock radio with that off, so you can tune, you get all your stations, it'll just be like normal. As soon as you hit that, the radio side of it is interrupted and the signal becomes an MP3 signal coming in. You then use these buttons to control the MP3 player, fast forward, rewind, and then the mode, which is selecting the Bluetooth on the MP3. The MP3's also got its own FM tuner, which I might not need because this is FM, but that would control it. And then input to the SD card or input to the MP3 stick. There'll be an MP3 stick by the steering column, which you plug this, your MP3, your USB stick into the steering column, and then that is selected with this button. So you can select the stick by the column, the onboard sound, which will be built into the player, FM or Bluetooth. Now you hit the Bluetooth, you can pair the set, pair it up on Bluetooth with your phone. So if someone's in the car and they want to play their tunes, you can get them to connect up to your radio. So it's good that. So the set's there, the MP3 system, here it is. It's just simply a module. They're not very expensive. These are about 10 quid on eBay. The module is a 4-in-1 unit, FM, Bluetooth, MP3, and then line in if you wanted it on that auxiliary. So that needs to connect to this. And we do that by building a box over here. I've cut that out of a plastic project box. This slots in the front. And then what we do, we interface these relays here, interface with the board. When I press one of these switches, you'll see that I've added some micro switches into the set. So let's see if the camera can pick up one of the micro switches. Probably the easiest one to spot, the right hand one. You'll see that micro switch activates there, just right in the middle of your screen, that little tiny switch. And that controls relays here, which in turn emulate these buttons on the front of this. So all you're doing is paralleling across these buttons. So this is just being piggybacked with those relays. And then the signal out of this comes out on one of these audio jacks here. Touch my thumbs on it there, which then goes into that input to the set. That's all I'm doing. I'll give you a demo of it when it's running, because I know that probably is a bit double dutch. I do apologize. Trying to explain this technically is difficult for me. I can see it in my head, but just trying to, you'll get a clearer picture when I start putting it together anyway. Quality wise and build wise, I've gone for the loom in Ford grey loom tape just to keep everything nice and neat. I've made this loom up. You'll see it coming into the set with a grommet at the back. I've had to drill through the set with a grommet. A multi-plug here to disconnect the radio from the MP3 if we have to take the set out, and then that carries on going and comes out into here. So I'm going to carry on now doing a bit of soldering and a bit more wiring, and we're going to get this set up and running on the bench, and we're going to listen to it and start controlling the music. We should have that done in a couple of hours. So I'll put the camera on the tripod. Sorry that this isn't a welding video just yet, but it's all about showing you how we get the wiring harness ready and built to cover all the electronic modules which will be going in. If I take you across here to this goodie box, you'll see that in the goodie box we've got other electronic components ready for the car. Spare wiring, which I've stripped off an old piece of machinery, so you don't have to buy any cable. The Kenwood subwoofer, which is the same as Swampy's, fits nicely under the passenger seat. That's getting built into it. The electric L, which you saw me fitting in 15, that's there ready to be built into the loom. The immobiliser system, part of it, is here. Tweeters are also in this box. The Bluetooth hands-free for the mobile phones in here, that's getting built in. So you can see there's quite a lot of components there getting built into the dashboard. The dashboard itself, well, we've got that nice new panel mocked up on the front. That's within all been painted and done. And then we're just working on the wiring runs and how long a cable's got to be for the audio system. The actual car wiring loom itself, in this instance, as opposed to Swampy, I'm not going to alter the vehicle's wiring loom as such. So that's just going to be going straight in. on Swampy, I hacked into the wiring harness behind the dash. I won't be doing that on this one. I'll be doing separate harnesses that are just part of the loom, and they'll be taped to the rest of the loom separately to make things easier. I learned that from Swampy. I built some wires into the dash harness, and really it made it difficult if you were fault finding. I haven't had any faults, but to be fair, I put wires in there and I can't remember what the hell I put into that loom. I'd rather know where I am and say, right, there's that wire, I can follow it through. So that's what's going on at the moment whilst we wait for that shell work. And there'll be other jobs too that I'm doing to do with ancillary items, wing mirrors and stuff like that. I've got to be lined up, but just for now, that's where we are. Okay, so I'll keep you updated. Okay, hopefully you can see my hands all right there. I've got you on the tripod just up above. And here we are now. I'm just going to work out my next plan of action for the set. I'm going to clear the bench because it's got messy. It soon gets messy when your brain's just trying to multitask all the different jobs and things that you're doing. So I'm going to clear the bench. It's a bit cluttered. Let's get a nice clean area set up for you. And then we'll do a little bit of soldering, and we'll see if this MP3 starts to boot up. At the moment, it's not even connected into the set yet. We need to get that powered up. Get the line output, get an MP3 stick in there. Let's just check, we'll get a speaker connected, we'll get some power on, we'll just see if it starts to come to life. Okay, I won't do too much on the electronics in case it gets a bit too much on the video. So I'll just give you a little overviews now and again what's been happening. And I think eventually you'll get the idea of what I've actually done, because I do appreciate that trying to explain this in one hit like I've just done now, you might just be a bit confusing, and I've probably not explained it the best that I can. I'm not really used to going through the electronics side. I tend to find a lot of it's all in my head, and it comes out of my hands just automatically, and difficult to preempt what you're actually doing. You tend to work on the fly. I have done this, I've just built as my mind unfolded. But that's that diagram you saw earlier on the whiteboard, that helps me to focus where I need to be. Right, let me just clear the bench, I'll do a few little bits, and I'll keep updating you every 20 minutes, every half hour, okay? There'll be no electric guitar on this video. I'm sorry about it. It's a very technical video, so we apologise. But for the techie guys, they're going to like it. For the welding guys, sorry about that. But we'll still be throwing in some shell stuff too. Don't worry, it's going to be a long film. It's an hour and 10 minutes, hour and a half movie for part 16. So there's going to be a lot in it. There's also going to be quite big time gaps. I can see there being a big time gap for you here. So this could be a month in production, this part of the film. We're going to slow down a little bit, but when all the shell and everything comes together, it'll speed up again. So just bear with us at this time. Okay, you've seen the power pack connected up there, 12 volt regulated supply, 12 volts DC to the set. So we're going to boot up. I'm going to get your set on now. I'm going to take you through it. So I switch on down here. It's all a bit crazy at the moment. We should be lit up on the set. You can see that red light on there. I've added, just behind the Ford logo on the set, there's a little LED. When that comes on, that shows that power's coming out of the set, the MP3 module. I've got a USB stick in there ready. This relay here I've connected, this switch is the audio input, that's the audio input switching relay. And then we've got inside there those relays there, the fast forward control relays, and the mode relay. They've got to be soldered across the contacts in here. If I flip the module up, I've got to get a very fine soldering iron and just parallel across the control buttons. So all the set will be doing is equivalent to my finger pressing these. That's all it's going to do, with the addition of the audio switch. So we've got the radio on now. So normal radio. So we tune. Now what happens when I press this, we'll get that red light on. Music mode. Saying music mode on the Bluetooth. There we go, we're straight in. So let's have a look. So we're off. Okay, so we're running good. I like the sound. I'm Now, I can't, at the moment the fast forward buttons aren't linked into the relays over here, so we're going to use the remote control on the module. So let's skip a track, that's pause, we don't want that, we want fast forward or jump track. There we go. We've got something else on now, don't know what it is. It's Michael Jackson. Oh, come on, boogie down. Let's make sure that red light goes out when I power this off. Oh yeah, and that shuts down. That now goes back to radio. So we're back to a normal FM set. Obviously long wave and medium wave, I need the aerial for them. Let's get back on, and you should see this boot up.
Music mode.
And away we go, that's nice. Now let's try the Bluetooth out. If I press mode on the button, we should hook up to my phone. I've got the phone paired up and ready. That's radio. Oh, it's our FM radio built in. Let's tune the radio. I'm not going to get much because there's no antenna on it. I don't really know what the stations are. Seek, there's auto seek. So we've got auto seek, radio free. So there's no antenna, so it's going to struggle. Not much to report on the radio.
Your relaxing music mix.
Okay, so radio. Now. Audio input mode. That's line in. We don't want any line in connected. Right, Bluetooth now.
Bluetooth connected.
So my phone should play this song, House Martins. There you go. So that's Bluetooth hooked up. So got it all there. So that's how it works. So obviously I can't control it yet. I'd have to hit them micro switches, but you'll hear them click. Have a listen. So we're just waiting for a very fine soldering iron now across here and then link into those relays, then we're fully running, we can box all that up, I'll get these relays glue gunned in position and we're ready to go. So it's all up and running and working, no interference, it sounds a clear signal. Let's go back to the USB stick. Where are we? Mode. You got equalizer settings as well. Pop, classic, jazz, country, normal, rock. Volume as well, but you don't need the volume. Great. So I'm gonna box this up and I'm gonna get them very fine wires soldered on now, so we're looking good on that. Okay, we're looking good. Just putting some finishing touches now to the unit. It's all laid out and I've spaced everything out and glued everything into place. So there's my line switching relay. That's my positive pad for my bus bar for the positive. Any more positive feeds, if I had to modify or add anything, there's a block there for us to solder onto for 12 volts. Negative pads there, just on the side of the relay. That's just a bit of Vero board stuck on the side. MP3 units in there. We've piggybacked the USB rather than going in from the front. I've piggybacked it on a flying lead at the back. It just means because this is going to be hidden in the car, this unit, it's actually going underneath the glove box but pointing to the passenger's feet. So the idea is that you can plug your aux lead into there by leaning under the glove box and plugging in. You can also plug in a USB, but for my USB on my driver's console, I'll be using this on an extension cable. So I brought a short lead out at the back. And what I'll do, I'll get a half meter extension cable, just connect that to it, and that'll go to the steering column shroud. So we'll have this MP3 stick, this USB stick, by the steering column shroud. So it's easy to just plug in. Same as I've got on my other car. So that'll be plugging in right by your ignition barrel, on the left hand side of it actually. I don't know if piggybacking USB ports works. So in other words, if I put another disc in there, what would actually happen? I don't think the device is designed to have two, so really we shouldn't use that front one if there's already a stick in here. I don't know what would happen if you try both. I'd probably confuse it, I would have thought. Anyway, that doesn't really matter. I just needed to add a fuse, so I've just lifted this cable up here. Our fuse is going in now, so I'm just going to solder on the main feed to the MP3 system. So we're just going to pop the power feed onto that fuse holder. I'll go on the... just got to get the solder iron in without burning my lovely loom. And we go for tinning of that, and then just pop the feed at the bottom. I'm just trying to think the right way around this should go now. Feed normally is the end one, because you don't want the end of the fuse holder live when the fuse pops, so you put it in the top. That one's on. Now we're going to bring in the actual power cable to power the whole unit up. It's going to be on a quick release plug here, these Molex plugs. So we want to bring in this just through that hole onto there to supply the feed. We should just have enough room through this hole. If not, I'll have to put another hole in. I think we can get that in. So I'll be bringing that in. That goes straight to the fuse. Then I'll link the other earth wire up to that, and that's our feed. So I'm going to poke that through, solder that up, and then this end becomes part of the wiring harness to plug in. So that's where we're up to, neatly laid out. I'm going to stick this loom back. There's a little sticky pad on the back with a crop with a rip tie, just to keep this nice and tight. I'll put some cable ties on the end of each one of these, so if you pull it, it can't pull out and rip out. So we're looking all good. We're going to have a grand testing in a minute, but that's how it's looking so far. And I'll pass you the radio set underneath the camera lens. It's a nice and steady angle, that camera lens, at the moment. There's the set coming up now. There's our set. If you can see, you'll see the micro switch alterations there. It's a little bit crude, but it's very effective and works. I've never had a problem on my other sets doing this. You see how that activates that switch, and then your data for it all comes out on this lead. I say data, it's just simply grounds, a series of switched grounds controlling the relays in the breakout box. And then you see that DIN socket there, that's the input for the amplifier stage. Radio signal out, amplifier input in, loops round into this box. So that's the set. There's a front view of the set. It's a nice set. Because I'm doing Ruby in red, what I've done, I've modified this. I've had this bezel off, and I've done... see what I've done to the set. Just behind here, I took all that out. I've repainted this so it reflects better for the illumination of the set. Internally, it had faded. But inside there, inside here, there's a red strip of perspex, and that shines onto the buttons and illuminates them with a sort of nice red glow. So it's a two-tone colour. You get the white illumination here, or the bulb type illumination, that glow of a bulb, filament type illumination, slight brown hue to it. And then underneath here, these buttons get a nice gentle red silhouette around them. So that's quite good. I'll pop it back on and then get back onto this job. Right, just going to hook up, got the positive feed onto the bottom of the fuse holder. Now I've put a bit of heat shrink sleeving onto the earth. Just going to make a join because I didn't plan on this connector. It was an afterthought, so I'm just going to solder the two wires together, slide over the heat shrink. That covers the cable nicely. We'll get some flame on that now. Just going to get my heat gun, and which is missing. Heat gun is missing. I'll have to look. Oh, here we go. We'll have to just a flame on that now. A little mini flame gun. It's quite a big flame from that. Shouldn't be using something that large, but you've got to be real quick. Right, that heat shrinks that on. So we are done there. Pair those up just to make it neat. These get paired so you know they're coming in as a pair. We're using this cloth automotive tape. Just looks a bit more pro. Just pair those bad boys up. So, we're neat as we can be for what it is. Now bring this cable down and under the fuse. That completes the install. Just got to feed that back out. It's a little bit cramped now. We're maxed out on space in here for sure. That just feeds under there. There we go, we're in. And that just attaches on its sticky pad, which is probably knackered now. It might be super glue if it is. There we go, we're on. So, fold that back over there, because that's complete. And everything is neat. That's it. Now the lid. This should all close up nicely. Lid on and you're good to go. So that's our module all done, all boxed. So a 12 volt feed, fuse at the side. We need to put in a 1 amp fuse into there. Some MP3 at the end, USB MP3 stick. Power feed there. So I'm going to do a temporary feed to test it, but this will be built into the back of the wiring harness on the dashboard, so it'll be ready to hook up. This module will just slot into place and pick up that feed. A non-Ford feed, of course, but you can't do everything like a car. So I'm really pleased with that layout. I think it's nice and neat. Let's test it, see if it goes. Pop the lid on and we'll give it a... Okay, a first test now. So everything back in the box, everything hooked up. We're on FM at the moment on the set. So we just tune away, there's no aerial, so I'm going to tune out, tune back in. Strong station there. I don't think we'll get anything else. You've got long wave and medium wave buttons as well, but no aerial, of course. So we're all running. The telltale light is off, so we want MP3 module, so we hit that, we get the telltale light.
Music mode.
System boots up, and we're off. So it's reading off this stick at the moment. So that's running nicely. Let's try skipping a track. There we go. Fast forward the tracks. Rewind. Mode button. My radio, FM, change stations, and we're not going to pick anything up without our antenna. Bluetooth,
audio input,
so that's the jack at the front here, that'll be underneath the glove box, we can plug in.
Waiting to be connected.
Bluetooth.
Connected.
So that's onto my phone at the moment again. So we're off this. All coming out of this bad boy. You can even control the phone with these buttons. So I'm going through my mobile now with this. Okay, so you do get that Bluetooth noise, I noticed, but I'm not that worried about that. It was a bonus feature anyway. It's because a lot of electrical equipment in here, and Bluetooth can make a sort of transmission sound. It's not a big deal. Let's switch back to MP3. So it remembers where you left off. And if we do a full power off on that switch, okay, normally what would happen is when you power off on that switch, it's going to control this and switch off that as well. So I'm going to do that next so that this turns off the whole system. It's not currently wired to do that, so we'll do that next. Right, I've just remembered why that doesn't go off with this. That's because this box connects to a secondary box, which is the electric aerial output box, which connects to this wire. So we're currently not running on that just yet. I can simulate it in a minute by just hooking the wire across. I'll do that now. Fully set up, everything's off, so turn this, and everything boots up. So that concludes the build for the MP3, all done. It's a few hours work there, maybe I'd say eight hours altogether, because I was working on it last night as well. But it's a nice unit that'll fit under the glove box on. I don't know if a Velcro pad will hold it, might do if I have a large enough Velcro pad, but it's going to mount. So you're going to be under here at the back of your dash, you're going to be under that panel there, probably just down around this area. We'll have to inspect it, but it's going to be enough cable to move it around where we want. Obviously the set is straight coming out here, and our wiring harnesses are nice and neat. You can see those nice neat cables. This second cable here, this is the audio link, and that's a high screen cable. That's a double screen computer grade cable, so that we don't get any interference picking up on the line feed. So really good quality cable you've got to use if you're extending the line feed on your set. That's double insulated. It's double screens with the foil and the braiding. It's a real nice piece of cable I got off a scrap computer lead. Most of the parts were just off the shelf or eBay. The heart of the unit, it's only £10 for that player, which is incredible value for money for what you get. It's seriously good. For all the features on it, really impressed, especially the Bluetooth bonus feature, just gives you a little extra edge. So that gives you a real nice period radio, fully genuine. As soon as I hit that switch, a full genuine set with no alterations to the sets, except for the micro switches, completely interfaced in with this unit here. So that's concludes that section. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to box the radio up, tidy up the rest of the wires, put the lids on it, put the fascia on, put them side by side and see how they look together, and then one final test for our MP3 system. Once that system's done, we've got all our cables ready to splice into the loom, and then we can start looking at the second system, which will be the electric aerial breakout box, which is basically a power box relay coming off this, which is going to feed a couple of other items: electric aerial, the Bluetooth power feed, and I think there's something else, the electric aerial output controls, I can't remember what it is. Then I'm going to look at the possibility of a dimmer display for the interior illumination on the radio. If this is too bright, I can't see what it's like at the moment. If it's too dim, I might do an LED conversion on this fascia. It's easy to take this off and to get to the bulb and do an LED conversion. We'll look at that separately when it gets dark. I'm going to see what the illumination looks like on this. You can see the red glow in there in the camera lens. It looks like it's all in one place, but it actually spreads out across. I'm going to see what that dial looks like in the dark. If I'm not happy with it, then I'll be changing it for LEDs. You'll see the forward sign light up now when I switch that on. And we become Bluetooth. We become MP3. Fast forward. So there you have it, off we go. All done for this, we'll see you in the next section. And continuing on, getting ready to set the subwoofer up, wired the subwoofer loom in position. I'm just getting ready to connect it up to the whole box of tricks up this end. Very quickly my desk got messy, I've even cleaned it up twice now. Sorry about the mess. Right, well, what's happened in the last day? I'm on with continuing to test the MP3 setup. The bezel's on the front there now, that's arrived, that's nice. Look at that bezel, lovely, in matching wood. I've built a breakout box for the auxiliary, well it's actually, I call it the antenna box. What this is the radio itself didn't have antenna live out, so when you switch on your set you need a live trigger coming out to activate the antenna, but also I need to activate a couple of other systems. I want to be activating the subwoofer drive, and also I need to activate boot up the MP3 with its relay here. So that required multiple outputs. What I didn't want to do is have the radio driving three different auxiliary items off its own power switch. I wanted it to fire a relay, which would then in turn boot everything up. So the radio, there's no loading on that volume switch. If something went wrong and I burnt the volume switch out, I'd have to take the radio to bits. By just connecting a relay to the output of the on-off switch here, and that's just a relay and a fuse and an LED in this box, that gives me multiple switched outputs off the radio, so all these become live or 12 volts when the radio is switched on. So that's all that does. So I connect the MP3 module to this, I connect the electric aerial to that, and I connect the MP3 to that, and if there's any other items which would be powered by the radio, you'd connect them to this box, everything protected by that fuse there. So rather than take out the radio, if you say, let's say my subwoofer failed, it would take out this fuse here if it's a low powered side of the subwoofer. If the output stage went, the subwoofer has its own fuse for that, but that's a master protection fuse that'll be also going under the glove box. So that's all that box does, just gives us multiple live outputs that are controlled with the on off button on here. Right, moving on to the radio, everything's running, but reading up on this device to do, whilst I've got FM on here. Okay, I've got FM, I've also got FM built into this unit. So two lots of FM, not really needed the FM on here. However, it's there as a function and it's got auto-tune on it. So laziness-wise, I'd like to just be able to auto-tune using these buttons. Problem occurred in that I've got fast-forward, okay, fast-forward there, rewind, and the mode switch to switches Bluetooth, MP3 line in, or FM. I haven't got an auto seek button. The auto seek button on this is controlled with the play and pause. Well, I've not needed to use that, so it's not wired in, so it wasn't included on the DIN plug. It's not included on this DIN plug here, and there's no button spare to use an extra control. Plus, I wanted to keep the controls on this quite simple. I didn't want to have more than three controls, so it starts getting confusing. So what I've done to get round it, I've built this extra little unit here, which I call a doubler. Okay, now it's not actually an electronic doubler in the true sense of electronics. Doublers are usually things with double voltages. This makes use of the button, in our case the mode button. It gives it a dual purpose. So what happens is, normally the fast forward control here would fast forward, but if you press the mode button once, it will latch this, it will hold, charge this relay here, which then diverts the fast forward button and makes it control the play and pause. So, and then this, after 5 seconds trips back out and the fast forward reverts back to fast forward. So it's simply a timer that's energized by the mode switch on the front of the radio, which then activates a relay which then diverts the fast forward button to the play pause input on the MP3. And that means now if we look, we can auto tune it. So let's just see, we've not got an aerial again. I'm going to go mode. Line in.
Waiting to be connected.
Bluetooth.
Music mode.
Music.
Radio.
Okay, so radio's on. Let's assume it's not tuned. Well, there's no way I can auto-tune that. I'm stuck with the presets that it comes with, so you actually can't use the FM. It's just stuck with its presets. What I'd have to have done is to pre-load all the stations into the module, and then hope that when I drive around the country in the car, that the FM channels are all going to be the same. They're not. You need a local auto-tune facility. It'd be nice to be driving into, you know, go from Manchester to London, get halfway there, and then you hit auto-tune and lock onto the latest stations. Why is that good? Because traffic is often on FM. Sometimes if the traffic on the sat-nav fails and you still want to get in touch with the real world, okay, I could start scanning on here if that happened, but it'd be nice to just auto-tune and lock onto the first 15 or 12 stations, which is what this records. I think it holds 12 stations. So I couldn't do that, but now we should be able to. I'm going to hit mode, and we're going to see what we get. We've got Bluetooth,
music,
radio. Now if I hit fast forward, we now have auto-seek. The fast-forward has now become the play-pause button. It's now going to auto-seek out all the stronger stations. So you'd be driving along and let it do its thing. Not particularly strong. If I hold the aerial at the back, it might get better. Right, so it's now found the strongest stations, and if I hit fast forward now, it won't auto-seek, it'll just go through the programs. Okay, so I know it might appear confusing, it's not. So, go back to music. Line in. Music, and it's actually becomes pause as well. I didn't have pause before because it's obviously emulating that button. After sort of 5-6 seconds, that relay will have tripped out, and this is now back to a fast forward button. And the mode button again. Music mode on again. So you can pause it, release it. And now it's back to fast forward again because the relay's tripped out. So we've got dual function buttons on the front, which is great, which it means that you're not complicating yourself. You're just using these three all the time. You just have to memorize the sequence. I can do it by just memorizing the sequence now. So, the radio. And that's auto-seek straight away, so it's now auto-seeking. So it's doing that auto-seek again and locking in the station. So that's all I do when I'm driving. Do that once, then it's done, and then you're out of there. Okay, and cancel out by just going to mode button. Back to music. So we can pause. We weren't able to do that before. And it just becomes back. So you've got 5 seconds on this for it to become a dual function button, then it reverts back totally into normal. All it's doing is toggling the inputs to the switches across there. So that makes it fully functional now, because I think it would have been annoying. I would have been annoyed if, not annoyed, but it just niggled at me knowing that it's got FM on it that I'm not using at all. It just seems a shame. Just may as well have the feature, and for the cost of that, that was 70 pence plus the relay to build. There's a tip 121 transistor, I think. There we've got 100 microfarad capacitor and 5k resistor on the charge side, a couple of diodes stop it back feeding into the relays, and that simply gives you a dual purpose. So we're done with that. Now what we've got to do is get the aerial toggled across. Here's the aerial for the FM unit coming out here. It's on a strange, normally on a shielded cable, for some reason it's just a piece of ribbon. It doesn't actually say antenna on the board, but when you hold this you get a lot stronger radio signal, so it's got to be antenna. Here it is. If I paralleled that with the set, okay, and just put it in piggyback with the aerial on the set, what happens, it pulls down the medium wave signal. Medium wave signals aren't very strong. FM's not too bad, but it will pull down the strength and mess up the tuning of the aerial, because it'll affect the actual tuning length. Okay, so I don't want that to happen. So we can use our slave unit to drive another unit. I don't think I'll fit the relay in here, but another unit, which again is going to be a relay, which will toggle the radio aerial input. So we would have the back of the antenna, the electric antenna, coming into the relay box, and that would then toggle between aerial for this unit or for the radio itself. So as soon as I power off the MP3 with the power off button, and this is reverting back to the radio, it would knock out the relay and it would switch the aerial back into this and take the aerial away from that. So you're not sharing the aerial between two electronic devices and interfering with the signal. I'm not quite sure why you can't share a radio signal. It's probably the circuitry in this will pull it down, and you can get a back feeding problem with the medium wave picking up the electronics and all sorts. It's just best to keep them totally isolated. Just remember to can't use the breakout box to boot up the relay. It needs to be on the power out of the MP3 button. If I turn that off, I don't need an aerial, do I? So we're not using that breakout box to power the antenna flip relay. We're going to use the power feed of this button. I'm going to build that now. I think I might be in luck, because there's a spare relay set of contacts. The audio switching inputs relay has got a spare set of contacts, so I could use that to switch the antenna. So I'm going to try it. I've paired off I've got some 75 ohm cable here, air antenna cable, and I've fitted a female socket at the end. That's for the aerial incoming, so the aerial signal come in, then it'll either route through these relay contacts here straight back out to the set on the end of this plug. Where are we? That plug in the back of the set, or it'll go to the middle pin, or not the middle pin, the out one, the outer pins, to the our digital tuner. Or say digital tuner, it's not really, is it? It is a digital tuner, but it's not a DAB, so that's got a solder across it. So I'm hoping that relay, I'm just going to meter it, make sure they're not connected to the audio, those spare set of pins. So we've got a spare set of pins, and that comes on with the on off button. So why have an extra relay or have to make an extra breakout box when I can just about, there's just enough room to bring the antennas into this module here, solder across there. Just got to do link the earths up on the shielding here now, and then wrap some foil around it, then some heat shrink tubing and make that neat. We'll do that now. Well, here we are about to make the connection to the antenna swap over relay, and things are mega tight. There's just about enough space to get this in, and also just to get the bend on the cable to come into the unit. There's my output to the radio. My input is on the middle pin there. That's the input from the aerial itself, and this little pin's got to just bend across, and then we've got to get the solder on there. So we'll tin up first, and I'm just trying a bit of tension on it. So this is the toggle relay. It's toggling the antenna between the radio itself, the original Blaupunkt set, and the MP3 combined FM electronic tuner. So aerial in, normally closed contacts here, so aerial straight back out again. The earths are looped together there. Relay energizes because I switched on the MP3 system. That set of contacts you saw earlier there, the audio switching inputs. So the antenna now goes across to this pin and disconnects from the radio. So we now pick up this aerial from the MP3 unit, and we solder that onto there. So we'll do that. solder that on. I'm hoping there's a ground loop between all of this, but we'll know if this is working by the quality of the sound, or the reception I should say, not sound, the reception. Just going to get that last pin on. You need a nice fine iron when you're doing stuff like this, when you start getting down to the real tight spaces in project boxes and things and circuit board work. This is a little 15 watt iron. I've got a few, I've got a 15, a 25, a 40. That's a little Antex 15. Oh, 12 watt, sorry, 12 watt. Okay, right, done. That is it. I don't know how this is going to work, I don't know if it's going to work at all, so I'm going to find the antenna, which is actually, at the moment, it's plugged in the back of the Blaupunkt directly. The antenna's extended, I've powered the antenna up and left it in the upright extended position. I'm plugging in my antenna feed here, just to the right of your screen. Those are new plugs there. In we go. Right, picked up. So, I now plug this the other end of this cable, which I've built this plug up. That's an off the shelf plug, and then stripped back the antenna cable and then fitted the plug. That's coming out, and that now goes into the back of the set. Let's hope this type plug fits. I should have checked if this fitted the radio. It says radio on the packaging. That seems to go in. I'll have to open the cover and see if that's engaging. Not sure about that. Should do it. Look, the similar plug. Right, so it's all. That's in, there's no reason why this shouldn't boot up, and we'll see what happens when the boot up off screen. You're not going to see it, we're off, just off screen. I'm going to the radio with the croc clip. I'm ready to boot up, power feed now on. I've booted up, well, I've got on screen and play the track. Right, so I'm on MP3 at the moment. I'm still on for the switch to right radio, so we can hear electrical interference now. Doesn't sound good, does it? Let's just see. I've not heard that noise before. It could mean that it needs auto-tuning again, but it's certainly picking up some kind of interference there. Let's just go through the stations. Oh no! Oh, we're okay. No, we're sounding good. Let's take it down so you can see what's going on. Ooh! Right, so I'm here on a radio station. There's our antenna setup. I suppose. Whoops, camera's gone. I suppose we'd know if we powered down. There's the electric aerial. If we powered down, it should lose signal, shouldn't it? Let's just see what's going on. Everything seems to be working. Let's do our auto tune and just see. Time to test the auto tune. Okay, radio. Auto tuning, off we go. Faster auto tune with the aerial up.
That they have people.
Right, it's picked up 15 stations. Obviously, it's picking up some FM home. It's probably my transformer. But I've got.
Hotels in a.
Okay, so we got that and it auto-tuned all right. There's a downside, of course, with auto-tune, and that is if there's a lot of stations close together, you might run out of presets by the time it's found them all. So that's the only downside. But let's see if we get this working. I need to power off. I'm back to that. Oh, we need to get onto FM, sorry. Good signal so far. Yep. Everything's still there. That hasn't affected the antenna, so it's working. The antenna relay switch is a goer. We're in luck. Great news. That's great. So that's it. I'm happy about that. Everything's working as it should, so we're all boxed off. So there you go. That's made use of that relay. That relay's certainly packing its use out of that one. We're crammed in there now. Look at that. Whole thing is crammed full. Okay, on to the next job, and that's getting the power pack. We've got a 30 amp power pack here. That's going to be booting up our subwoofer. We're now going to clear the bench. We're going to get that subwoofer connected up. Close the lid on that because it's done for there. We've got these tweezers here as well. We're going to just get the bench clear and the subwoofer on, then we're going to have a grand demo, okay? Sorry about the mess, I'll clear everything up now. I just tend to work off the top of my head and everything just unfolds everywhere. So all looking good. I've got to get that to fit in there, get the lid back down. Okay, sub is in. We're down on the floor for the sub and I brought in the bigger power pack. This is a 30 amp power pack. Set that now just for 12.5 volts, 13 just on the gauge. We can dial in any power we want with that amp there, with that power pack, which is 30 amps max, with a 3 amp auxiliary 30 amp on the terminals on the left. So that's powering the main feed to the amp. Radio's now hooked in as well on the banana plugs for the front. All the modules are here laid out ready to boot up. Electric aerial is folded down because we're powered off. There's the subwoofer control. This sets the frequency and the volume and the phasing. We don't really need the phasing because I've only got that sub, and these speakers at the moment won't be pushing out anything to knock the phasing out. So yeah, we're ready to go, ready to switch on. So we're going to switch on with MP3 off, just an FM radio. So our electric aerial fires up and our auxiliary output box lights up, supplying power to the sub now, or the trigger to the sub, should I say. There's the sub lit up, sub controls lit up. That's the under seat subwoofer control. So turning up the volume. Okay, so we're just on FM, tune in as normal, and we should hear the sub delivering what it needs to deliver. Yeah, I can hear that nicely. We set it how we want. So that gives a fuller sound. Let's see how we fare up on MP3. And we've got a... Okay, we're all ready to test the subwoofer and the MP3 now. I've got everything wired up. So our subwoofer is on the floor over there. Just put it out of the way. There's a long lead on that you get with it. So that's over in the corner. To power that sub, I've got a 30 amp DC supply over there. That big bad boy of pop. Gives a 3 amp output on the push terminals at the front, then the screw, banana plug and screws at the side gives us a 30 amp output. So that's a beast. I've set that on 13 volts, 12.5 volts. Okay, so we have that running, ready to go. Set's all done, we're plugged in. So here's our module. We can put that stick actually now and emulate it being by the centre console. So that would go in there if I can do it one-handed. I'm not sure if I can. Yeah, I should be able to. Just put that into the extension lead socket. I don't think I'll be able to do it. Hold on. Like that. Okay, so that would be by your steering column. Just up there. This, all these boxes will be hidden behind the dash. This will point down to the passenger's feet so that you've got access to the screen if you needed it. But it's I'll be Velcroing that onto the side. Once you've set that, I think you don't need to go near that box. Fuse at the side there. Auxiliary output box, fuse at the side, LED on. subwoofer control unit. This controls the frequency and the volume effect, and a phase switch, which is to match your speakers, your existing speakers in your car, so that all the speakers pull together and don't fight against each other. That's the phase switch. For mine, it won't be that much relevant because I've only got a dash speaker. That wouldn't really do it. Probably have a slight difference. And then the set itself, all ready to go. Electric aerials retracted. So we're going to start off with just an FM sound. So if I power up on the dial, we boot up for FM. Now we should find the electric aerial goes up, which it does. Up it goes into the roof. The subwoofer lights up. It's picking up the feed, the trigger feed, trigger box is on there, and this unit's off as it should be. So just FM, we need to find a station. Well, we're actually on, would you believe it, we're actually on long wave at the moment. But you won't get much on, you're going to pick up all sorts. I wouldn't expect long wave to get anything inside the building. It's trying. Medium wave, and these buttons are mixed up. We're not going to get anything there. So we go to FM, which is that one. I need to swap the buttons around. They're on the wrong way. So I've got a nice full sound straight away. I can hear that. So just gives us a nice full sound. So we'll boot up the MP3. We should be straight in. Off at the moment, of course. If I hit that switch, let's hit that switch. On we go. That comes on. I'm straight in. Tweeters on. Here's the tweeters. A nice full sound. We can tune that in how we need it. Let's fast forward. There's a Michael. Oh, here we go again. We like this one, don't we? So that sounds great. So that's all as it should now. Let's try another song. What we got? Anything interesting? Pet Shop Boys. Sound of Silence. Simple Minds. Oh no, not Simply Red. Blues Brothers. Sounds great. That's how it all works. Well, that's all boxed off. Wow, quite a mission. And oh, let's test that electric aerial. We've not tested that, have we? So well, you can see the antenna plug here just there, and then going into the back of the set just there through its switching system. So if I go
radio mode,
well, sounds nice. Obviously working now. If I pull the electric aerial control wire down, so we get no electric aerial, that retracts. You should hear the signal disappear off. Okay, it's gone a little bit crackly, but that's a strong station. So we're a bit crackly on that one. Put the electric aerial back on. This is just testing that the aerial system's switching properly. If I can get that in there. Thank you. the hissing's gone as the aerial's gone all the way up, so it's obviously picking it up. So that's good news. The flip-over relay box for the antenna switching inputs is great. Oh, and sounding nice too on FM. Oh, we don't tune it there, do we? It's a digital.
Question thing. Number two in the phone quiz this evening. Who lives in London's Mansion House? Who lives in London's Mansion House? That's number two.
I'm very pleased with that. A little boy shooting arrows in the blue. It's going to have picked up some weak stations too. Arguably, this digital tuner's as good as the analog. I don't know, when it does lock onto a station, it does sound good. It obviously locks onto weak stations too, that's the only downside. Not bad. Some hiss, but it's not high-end audio, is it, you know? For a little tiny 6-watt output set, what do you expect? You know, two little 6-watt, good quality transistors in this. They're well built, don't get me wrong. But you're not going to get booming sound, and that's not what I want. I'm just about on the first third of the dial. I don't really go high, you know. Just like to be around there. So, I'm really pleased with that. Shall we see if it locks onto my phone? Now, I've not come in knowing to have the Bluetooth on. Let's just see if it pairs up from the other day, actually. So we look for Bluetooth.
Audio input mode.
Now that's for your passenger if they're bringing their iPod with them.
Waiting to be connected.
There we go. Now you do get that Bluetooth noise. Is it going to find my phone? It might do, but I think I have to start playing the tunes on my phone itself. So that's something you've got to set up on your own.
Music.
So we'll wait for that one. And don't forget, I've got a couple of crap computer speakers. Well, Cambridge Soundworks aren't bad, to be fair to them. They're not designed for what I'm doing. And then the good quality Alpine tweeters up here, see, they'll be going in above the headlining. So they're running, but we need to just get the proper centre speaker now so we can gauge how to build the box and the enclosure. And then we're good to rock. So I'm going to wrap for today. So all that electronics mess has all concluded into these modules here, which we just fit in various positions around the back of the dash there. Okay, all our harnesses and plugs are all pluggable. So the set comes out on those plugs. And take you around the back of the set, you'll see how it all just plugs in. So that's running really good. There's that antenna you saw me messing with on the part 15. What can I say? We're done. Just a bit of a tidy up now, and resume next week. So hope you enjoyed that technical aspect. Other tech stuff will be coming up, but that's probably the most intense part, was to build all that for you. I'm pleased it's all come together and it's gone exactly to plan. And I've actually only got two boxes there. I managed to get that aerial thing all in the one box, which was a great little bonus move. So really pleased. Dual FM, Bluetooth, MP3, line in, medium wave, long wave on a genuine set. Nice sound. Subwoofer system. All you need, really. I mean, I've got that similar setup running in Swampy, and I don't ask for any more whilst I'm driving. It does everything I want. I'm not saying it's the best solution. You could put a proper amplifier on the back of this if you wanted and get some better sounds out. Door cards and shelf speakers, whatever you want. But as a bass system, I think that's great. Okay, over and out on this little section. Know your highway code.
This is in good nick, innit?
Aye. Tidy this.
Don't see many of these now.
Wear that.
About, is it?
No, it's
original colour as well, eh?
Sapphire, yeah, you got it. Well spotted.
Here you go. Connect the cables, here you go. Wait for the lightning strike. I don't think it's got a propeller.
Do not.
It's a winch, isn't it? So we could chop the cable and go for a pleasure cruise around the lake. He goes back. He go, open the gate, he go. Okay, yes, master. Yes, my master. Likes Cortina, so does he go. Come on, Ego, open the gates, Ego.
That's like
the bells, Master, the bells are ringing.
Is it on now? It doesn't look like it's even on.
That's red for the door.
Yeah.
The bells, Master, ring the bells.
All right.
off-road. Oh dear.
I don't think we're going to make that.
No.
Are they? We're going to get back.
Well, we can't reverse. We're stuck. As soon as you hear it ground out, it might not grind. It might, the exhaust might touch. I've done worse in hotel car parks.
Hmm. Saying
nothing.
Anything
yet?
No.
Can you hear anything yet?
No.
What you got? Can you hear anything yet?
I don't know. I don't know what I'm supposed to
do. Very loud crunching, it sounds like the car's being torn in half, that kind of noise.
No. Oh. Can you?
No. That's what I was imagining for things, it should have gone. It's made it. I can't believe it's got over that.
Can we get back over it?
Yeah, but if you got over it that way, you'd get over it back. I think we're plain sailing after that. We're nearly home. I used to try and dam that stream there.
Yeah.
I used to think I could stop it flowing if I put enough rocks across in a line.
And could you not?
Just goes round it.
It's wide, isn't it?
Spent hours putting rocks down there.
It's a bit bumpy, I can't help it. Whoever watches this will be seasick.
You'll need heavy editing. I can do it now. We're off road. It is actually off-road, this isn't, it's a track, it ain't a road. I'm going back to my family home. Oh yeah, remember those waterfalls there?
Yeah,
you could hear them from the cottage roaring at night. We didn't have electric either.
Really?
Nope.
So,
candles.
Which cottage was it?
Middle one.
With the brown door?
Brown door, yeah. It's an,
with a sticker outside?
Yeah, it's a hot youth hostel now.
How is it?
That was it.
Wow.
That is the family home. For a while. I've still got a dinky fire engine in that stream up there somewhere.
Yeah.
There's like some metal pipes and we used to put the metal pipes in the stream. Then throw the dinky toys down for some reason. Don't quite know what I was doing. But it was a fire engine, you could put water in it and squirt water out of the fire engine. And she'll come running down that grass there. Look, this was a rope bridge then, it's now a solid bridge, but that was a rope bridge.
Still a bit dodgy looking, isn't
it? I mean, for a May day, mid-spring, it looks bloody grim today, the weather.
Sheep up there, it looks frozen.
No, they're alright. That stream ahead was just a great thing to watch.
They outside toilets at the end. I bet they used to be, didn't they? It's all scruffy.
These are old buildings have all fallen down. There was all sorts of buildings here.
There?
Mm, and that's the slag heap there from the copper mine slag heap.
Right.
Well, that's the spoil out of the mines that they tipped. You don't realise it when you're a kid. You just thought this was normal, but it isn't.
No, it's not.
I just thought this is a normal place to live. Not that it's not a nice place, but to appreciate it now,
you
didn't at the time appreciate it.
So what did this used to be then, these buildings here?
I don't know, they were just like work buildings or something. I never knew what they used them for.
That's sheep funny.
There's hostels now and guest houses.
Yeah.
it's a great walk up. That tower up the top there, that's one of the winch towers.
Is it?
See if I can zoom in on it. That's a winch tower for the cables, for the pulleys, for the cars. They carry like the copper down in like baskets. That was what, like a winch house, it would pull up.
Is that probably not in use anymore?
Oh no, there is no copper mines.
Oh, is there not?
They don't mine copper here anymore.